Welcome, my dear learners, for this course on control engineering. From today, we are discussing the last module of this course, that is in module 5, we are discussing on board plot. What is this board plot? Why we are studying this in control engineering will be addressed in today's lecture. The basics of any frequency response system is to plot magnitude and phase angle variation for input frequencies. Now, the input frequency can be varied from 0 to infinity. So, if I vary the input frequency from 0 to infinity, I will get numerous variation of magnitude as well as phase plot. If I use linear scale, I cannot accommodate these variations of magnitude and phase angle plot for various values of omega, that is for input frequencies. Hence, the scientist by name H.W. Bode has suggested that if we use logarithmic scale, we can accommodate wide range of input frequencies and plot wide range of variations of magnitude as well as the phase angle plot for wide range of variations of input frequencies. Hence, the scientist by name H.W. Bode suggested that if we use logarithmic scales, the wide range of variation of input frequencies can be accommodated rather than using the linear scale. As we already studied in stability analysis of a system, if the roots of the characteristic equation lies on the right half of the S-plane, the system is said to be unstable. Or if the root moving towards the right half of the S-plane, starting from the positive value moving towards the positive infinity, then the system is said to be relatively unstable. In another way, if the roots of the characteristic equation lies on the left half of the S-plane, then the system is said to be stable, and if it moving towards the minus infinity, then the system is said to be relatively stable. This we have already studied in our root locus analysis. Now, when I used to get the characteristic equation of a closed loop control system is an higher order polynomial like 6th order and 7th order, then determining the number of poles, closed loop poles, which are nothing but roots of the characteristic equation, will become very, very difficult. In such cases, what we should do? We should go for RH criterion, that is Ruthwood's criterion. Without solving the higher order polynomial, we can state whether the system is stable or unstable. That is, if I solve for RH criterion for a higher order polynomial and look at the first column of RH criterion, if there are no sign changes, then the roots are all negative values. That is, if I plot the roots, all roots will come towards left half of the S-plane and the system is considered to be stable. If there are any sign changes in the first column of Ruthwood's array, then the roots of the higher order polynomial equation might be having positive values. Hence, the system will be unstable, which means that the roots, if I plot on a S-plane, will come on the right half of the S-plane. So, like this, we have studied numerous techniques to analyze stability of a system. Similarly, for a frequency response control system, the stability of a system can be analyzed with the help of board plot, which was suggested by H.W. Bode. Using board plot, we are going to determine gain margin, phase margin, using which I can tell whether the system is stable or unstable, which I am going to discuss when I take up problems on board plot. But now, as of now, the board plot is nothing but logarithmic plot of magnitude and phase angle of a frequency response control system, which varies for wide range of frequency inputs. I will vary the frequency, input frequency, and check what is the magnitude and phase angle variation, plot it on a logarithmic scale. By doing that, I can accommodate wide range of input frequencies rather than going for a linear scale. Hence, we should go for logarithmic scale. Now the question arises, the magnitude and phase angle will be in linear scale only, right? Let us say the magnitude is 60 and phase angle is 90 degrees. Then how to convert this into logarithmic scale is the question. For that, he suggested that the conversion of magnitude scale to logarithmic scale is very easy, that the magnitude, which is nothing but the magnitude of open loop transfer function, that is g of s into h of s, replace s by j omega. If I replace s by j omega, then the magnitude is nothing but what? If I have an equation, I will get the magnitude as square root of real part square plus imaginary part square, correct? Now I want the magnitude to be converted to logarithmic scale. So this is linear scale. In logarithmic scale, it is equivalent to 20 log 10 magnitude of g of s into h of s. So in order to determine the magnitude as well as phase angle, I should replace s by j omega, because s is nothing but complex plane. It involves both real part as well as imaginary part. S plane is nothing but a complex plane. It is a synonym of complex plane. So hence replace s by j omega to bifurcate between the real part and imaginary part. If I get real part and imaginary part, then magnitude is nothing but square root of square of real part plus square of imaginary part. Whereas phase angle will be tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. Now the linear magnitude should be converted into logarithmic scale. That's what Bode stated, because if I doing so, I can accommodate wide range of frequencies. How we are acquiring wide range of frequency? What is log 10 of base 10? Unity. What is log 10 of 100? Log 10 of 100 is nothing but 2, right? I can write it as log 10 of 10 square. So it is nothing but 2 log 10 base 10. That is 2 into 1, which is 2. Similarly, how much is log of 1000? Log of 1000 can be written as what? Log of 10 to the power of 3 base 10, which is nothing but 3 into log of 10 base 10. So log 10 base 10 is 1, since it is 3. So thereby the magnitude is varying in 1s and 2s, but we are plotting it in 10 to the power. So hence the wide range of frequencies can be accommodated if I go for logarithmic scale. So this is in linear scale, which is nothing but square root of real part square plus imaginary part square. This is equivalent to logarithmic scale if I replace the magnitude calculation with 20 log 10 of magnitude. So this is the conversion from linear scale to logarithmic scale for magnitude plot. So this is for magnitude plot. Now what I can say is that if one axis is log of omega, logarithmic of natural frequency, and another axis, so base 10, very important, log base 10, another axis is nothing but the magnitude, I can plot the variation. Similarly, I can plot the phase angle also. If I place phase angle on another axis, if I place log omega, I can plot the graph of variation of phase angle for various in variation of input frequencies. If I vary input frequency, the phase angle will vary. If I vary input frequency, the magnitude will also vary. The only difference is that I can cover wide range of input frequencies if I go for logarithmic scale. Now the careful observation reveals that the x-axis is same. It is logarithmic of input frequency base 10. So therefore, on a common base, on a common x-axis, I can plot both magnitude as well as phase angle. This is the advantage of Bode plot. The advantage of Bode plot is that on a common graph sheet, we can plot both magnitude as well as phase angle, because the x-axis is constant. X-axis is logarithmic of input frequency. So now we should analyze what is the variation of the contribution of magnitude and phase angles of various parameters of open loop transfer function. The open loop transfer function contains constant term, poles at origin, zeros at origin, simple pole, simple zero, complex pole, complex zero. These few people already learned in this course. Now what is the contribution of those individual terms present in the open loop transfer function g of s into h of s is the question to be answered. And how to plot it in a logarithmic scale is also a question to be answered now. Correct. So therefore, let me take one by one and analyze how to plot these in the logarithmic scale for magnitude as well as for phase angle. And to do that, I want to take the standard form of open loop transfer function, that is g of s into h of s. The standard form is already known to you people. Let me recall that. What is that standard form? The standard form is nothing but g of s. So So here replace s by j omega, because I want to analyze real part as well as imaginary part to determine the magnitude as well as the phase angle, correct? So g of s into h of s is equal to what? A constant. Next we have numerators are zeros, right? So s power n, let me say, if s to the, if n is 1, then we have 1 0 at origin. If s is 2, sorry, n is 2, then s square. S square stands for 2 zeros at origin. If n is 3, s cube stands for 3 zeros at origin. Next we have simple 0, that is 1 plus, let me take it as t1, s, and then we can have the complex part, that is 1 plus 2 zeta omega n s plus s square by omega n square, that is complex 0, divided by, we have simple pole s power m, let me say, and then we have 1 plus t a s pole, simple pole, pole at origin. If m is equal to 1, we have 1 pole at origin. If m is equal to 2, we have 2 poles at origin. So this stands for simple pole. So similarly, we can have complex pole also in the given problem. I am representing them in standard form. Whatever form they might have given, you should reduce this to it to standard form like this. Now I can analyze the individual terms. That is, we are discussing on board plot, introduction to board plot. So board plot is very simple. It is nothing but plotting magnitude and phase angle of an frequency response control system on a logarithmic scale, rather than doing it in a linear scale to cover wide range of variations of input frequencies. That's all. Now if I take constant term, consider constant term, let me consider constant term. Considered constant term. Now what is the magnitude of constant term in logarithmic scale? That is magnitude of g of j omega into h of j omega, which is equal to magnitude of k. Let us consider only it has k. G of s into h of s is equal to k. Let us consider only that. I don't have anything. Now I want the magnitude of that in logarithmic scale. So this can be written as what? It should have both real part as well as imaginary part, because we are discussing on S-plane. S-plane is nothing but a complex plane. It has real axis as well as imaginary axis. So therefore, this can be written as what? This can be written as k plus 0j, imaginary part, 0j. Now, what is the magnitude of this? What is the magnitude of this? Square root of real part square plus imaginary part square, which is nothing but k. Now, this is in linear scale, but what we are using is logarithmic scale. So what is the equivalent logarithmic scale? So equivalent logarithmic scale will be what? 20 log 10 of magnitude, 20 log 10 k, right? And whenever I do so, the unit will be converted into decibels. So this conversion will give us what? Unit in decibels, dB. dB stands for decibels. This is the unit in log scale, decibels. So I got it as decibels. So this will be in decibels, dB, right? Now you observe one important thing. This does not contain omega. This does not contain omega. So therefore, whatever frequency I might vary, it is constant. If this is 10, then the answer is 20. Vary omega whatever you want. Vary omega from 0 to infinity. Vary omega as 60, 70, 80, 100, 1000, whatever you want. This magnitude will not vary. Which means that what is this? This is a straight line. This is an horizontal line, correct? So therefore, what is the magnitude plot of constant k? It is a straight line. It is a straight line at 20 log 10 k, which is a constant. Now what about its angle plot? What about its angle plot? The angle of g of j omega into h of j omega which can be written as angle of a constant k plus 0j, correct? Now, which is nothing but what? Tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. Tan inverse of imaginary part is 0, real part is k. So angle is how much? Tan 0 is 0. So it is a straight line at an angle of 0. That's what I said. We can verify from the angle condition, the angle is coming to be 0 degrees for k. Hope you understood. So therefore, the constant term k is represented as a constant straight line. That is a straight line with no inclinations, horizontal line at an angle of 0 degree, which is plotted at a magnitude of 20 log 10 k. The unit will be in decibels. That is, when I converted the magnitude from linear scale to logarithmic scale, the unit is nothing but decibels. So this is I understood for constant term. Similarly, I can do analysis for rest all the terms. Let me demonstrate for one of these. Let me take pole at origin, because we usually encounter pole at origin. So if I consider pole at origin, what I can do? Let us take one pole at origin. If I have one pole at origin, if I have one pole at origin, what does it mean? G of s into h of s is 1 by s. It is not s square. That's why I am specifying one pole. Power is 1. Now, what is the magnitude plot? Replace s by j omega. G of j omega, h of j omega. This is, I want to see the both real and imaginary part. This can be written as 1 by s is nothing but what? J omega, right? So therefore, I can write as 0 plus j omega. Replace s by j omega. If I do it as j omega, real part is 0. J omega is what I got. Now, what is the magnitude of this? The magnitude of this is what? 1 divided by root of real part square, 0 square plus imaginary part square. So hence the magnitude is how much? 1 by omega. 1 by omega is the magnitude. So hence, in log scale, in log base 10 scale, what I can do? The magnitude of g of j omega into h of j omega, which is nothing but 1 by s, is nothing but what? 20 log 10 of magnitude. Magnitude is 1 by omega. Magnitude is 1 by omega. This is what I have. Now, vary the value of omega and see what happens. If omega is varied, and what is happening for magnitude? Put omega is equal to 1. Magnitude will be 0 because log 1 is 0. Let me check it properly. Let me don't do any mistake. 20 times log 10 of 1, 0. Now, let me take the value as 10. Let me tell you why I am going with 10. Log 10 is 20. That is, here it is what? 10 inverse, right? Sorry. It is 1 by 10 minus 20. Put omega is equal to 100. If we put omega is equal to 100, what I will get? Minus 40. So what it is showing us, if I put 1000, what happens? Minus 60 I will get if I put 1000. So if I connect these lines, what I am going to get? If I connect these lines, I am going to get a straight line whose slope is minus 20. So which means that the magnitude of poles at origin, the magnitude of poles at origin is nothing but a straight line with slope minus 20. Straight line with slope minus 20. Why I am taking 10, 100, 1000 is because log scale varies with 10 to the power. If you see semi-log sheet, I'll show you the semi-log sheet in our next lecture. When I take up numerical problems, the semi-log sheet will have 0.1, 10 divisions, then 10 to the power of 0, then 10 to the power of 1, 10 to the power of 2, 10 to the power of 3. Like this, we have the divisions in semi-log sheet. Like this, we have divisions in semi-log sheet. Like this, we have divisions in semi-log sheet. Semi-log sheet. Now, each 10 divisions are called as decade. Each 10 divisions of semi-log sheet are called as what? Decade. This is 1 decade. This is 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Like this, you can have how many decades you want. So, generally, we use 5 to 6 decade semi-log sheet. 5 to 6 decade semi-log sheet means till what you have? 1 decade, you will have 1. 2 decades, will have 10. 3 decades, will have 100. 4 decades, will have 1000. 5 decades, will have 10,000. 10 to the power of 4. So, these are called as decades. So, if I draw a line between the decade from 10 to 100 or from 1 to 10, how much it is decreasing? Minus 20. So therefore, what is my conclusion from the observation of magnitude plot? Since the log scale varies with 10 to the power, I am taking here also 10 to the power. Now, if I plot the magnitude, it is a straight line with minus 20. This I should plot here because this is a magnitude, this is phase angle plot. I should plot in this graph with the same line. Correct. So if I do that, what I am going to get? 0.1. After 10 divisions, I will have 10 to the power of 0, which is 1. After 10 divisions, I have 10 to the power of 1. After 10 divisions, I will have 10 to the power of 2, like this. So these are termed as what? Decades. These are termed as decades. Now mark the magnitude. At 1, it is 0. Let me say somewhere here I will mark 0. At 10, it is minus 20. At 100, it is minus 40. So connect it, you will get a straight line. Now what you are observing, it is decreasing by an amount of minus 20 per decade. So therefore, this magnitude plot is nothing but what? Straight line with what is the slope? With slope of minus 20 decibels per decade. Per one decade, it is decreasing minus 20. Hence, the slope is minus 20 decibels per decade. Hope you followed. So therefore, whenever you have the simple pole at origin, then its magnitude plot is nothing but a straight line with minus 20 decibels per decade. You know for what frequency you should plot that. So till that frequency, you plot a minus 20 slope straight line per decade. Now, what about its angle? What about its angle plot? If I move for angle, it is angle of g of s into h of s, which is nothing but 1 by angle of s, replace s by j omega, which is nothing but 1 by tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. Real part of this is 0, you know, right? This can be written as 0 plus j omega. Imaginary part is omega, real part is 0. So tan inverse of imaginary part by real part is omega by 0, which is nothing but 1 by tan inverse of infinity. Tan inverse of infinity is how much? 90 degrees. So hence, this is nothing but minus 90 degrees. The summing up the resultant is already explained in our discussion on root locus itself, where I used the conversion from rectangular form to polar form. This can also be done by converting rectangular form to polar form. This is in rectangular form. A plus IB, rectangular form. Imaginary part is B, real part is A. Whenever you have rectangular form, what you can do? Give omega whatever you want, 10, 100, 1000. So how to do that? Shift pole. Pole of real part is 0, comma, imaginary part is omega. Give omega whatever you want. Let me give 100. So look at that. The magnitude is 100, the angle is 90, correct? Which is nothing but tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. So I got the angle. Since it is in denominator, when I write it in numerator, it is minus 90. So what is the phase angle contribution of one pole at origin? The magnitude plot is a straight line of minus 20 decibels per decade, whereas its angle contribution is minus 90 degree. Now, if I have two poles at origin, what happens? If I have two poles at origin, in such cases what to do? So since we have discussed for pole, let me take it as zero. For better understanding, let me take it as zero. If I have two zeros at origin, two zeros at origin means S square term, n is equal to 2, which means g of s into h of s is equal to S square. If I have like this, then what to do is the question. So now, what is the magnitude plot? The magnitude is nothing but magnitude of replace S by j omega. So it is j omega into j omega. Like this you should write, j omega into j omega. Now how much I will get this as? This is equal to magnitude of j omega. Real part is 0, imaginary part is omega. So square root of 0 square plus omega square is omega square. Root of omega square, it is nothing but omega into this one, j omega. This j omega will give us what? Root of 0 square plus omega square. That is also gives us one more omega. Hence I will get what? Omega square. Hence I will get omega square. Now in terms of logarithmic plot, what is the equivalent? I am going to get modulus of S square is equal to 20 log 10 omega square. 20 log 10 omega square. Hence, in general, what I can write for this? In general, I can write it as 20 into 2 log 10 omega. Now vary the value of omega like this. Put omega is equal to 1, you will get 0. Put omega is equal to 10, you will get 40 plus 40, because omega is in numerator. Put omega is equal to 100, you will get the output as 2 times 40, 80. So like that it will keep on increasing. Now what is that we are going to get here? So therefore the magnitude plot what I will obtain here will be a straight line having plus 40 here, plus 40 decibels per decade. So magnitude plot is nothing but what you are going to observe. Magnitude plot is nothing but this is a straight line of plus 40 decibels per decade. That is, the contribution will be plus 40 per decade. So therefore, what you can conclude from this? S to the power of m is nothing but poles at origin. For poles at origin, you will have a straight line of slope minus 20 into m decibels per decade. If I have one pole, then it is minus 20. If I have two poles, then it is minus 40. If I have three poles, then it is minus 60. Like this, it will go on increasing. Similarly, for zeros, it is plus 20, plus 40, plus 60, like that. So that is, in general, I can write it as 20 into n is the slope, that is 20 into n decibels per decade. If n is equal to 2, I will get 40. If n is equal to 1, I will get plus 20. If n is equal to 3, I will get plus 60 decibels per decade. So per decade, you will have a straight line of having slope 20 times n. So since the slope is positive, the line will be like this. This line should move upwards, then the slope is positive. If the slope is negative, then line should go downwards, that is towards the fourth quadrant. Then you have the slope as negative. This you people already know. Okay, this is well and good. I understood. Now what about angle plot? What about angle plot for two zeros at origin. Now for angle plot, we know that angle of g of s into h of s must be equal to angle of s square, angle of s square, this should be written as j omega, right? So it is j omega into j omega. If you have cube, should write it like this, j omega into j omega into j omega thrice. If you have s power 4, 4 times you should write j omega, j omega, j omega, j omega. Then find the angles individually. Now what is the resultant? It is not multiplication, it is addition. This you already know. Now what is the angle of j omega? Angle of j omega is already done, right? Angle of j omega is how much? 90 degrees. So angle of j omega is 90 degree. This is also 90 degree. Now the resultant is what? Plus 90 plus 90, which is nothing but plus 180. So in general, what you can write? In general, you can write that the face angle plot for zeros, the face angle plot for zeros is nothing but plus 90 into numerator is n, right? Plus 90n, plus 90n. Whereas the face angle contributions or face angle plots for poles is what? Minus 90 into m. If I have one pole, then it is minus 90. If I have two pole, then it is minus 180. If I have three pole, then it is minus 270. That is S cube. If I have S cube, I should take the angle as minus 270. If n is 2, then it is plus 180. If n is 3, I should take plus 270. So hope you have followed how to determine magnitude as well as the face angle and their convergence from linear scale to logarithmic scale, which is very important because we are using semi-log sheets to plot the graph from which we are taking up the time response specifications. What do you mean by time response specifications? And also, we have not discussed the magnitude plot and angle plot of simple pole, simple zero, complex pole, complex zero. So if you do like this, you can get what is the magnitude plot for these four terms. For simplicity, I'll give you the tabular column indicating the resultant slope line and what is the contribution of angle for all these terms, and later I will explain what is time response specification for these board plot analysis. Let me pause this video for a while so that you people can copy it down. Later we'll continue the summary of these terms, individual terms. Now moving ahead, if I summarize what we have discussed so far, that is recollecting the open loop transfer function, what we have wrote, g of s into h of s is equal to a constant. Let us say there are n number of zeros, 1 plus t1s, simple zero, then I wrote complex zero. Pole divided by, let us have, there are m number of poles, simple pole, and we have complex pole. So this is the standard form of open loop transfer function, where in which the numerators are called as zeros, denominators are called as poles. This you people already know. Now coming for the summary, that is we have individual terms, right? Term, slope of straight line, slope of straight line, and the face angle, and the face angle. So if you know this summary, that is more than enough to solve problems. But how you got this summary is what I explained just now. Now, if I take the first term, what is slope of the straight line? Zero. Correct? What is slope of the straight line? Zero, right? And zero line at slope of the straight line is zero at 20 log 10 k. At 20 log 10 k, it is a constant line. What is the face angle? 0 degree. Now go for s power n. If I go for s power n, what is the slope of straight line? Slope of straight line will be plus 20, right? Plus 20 times n. Plus 20 times n. Whereas the face angle is plus 90 degree into n. Whereas if I go for simple pole, if I go for simple pole 1 by s power m, then the slope will be minus 20 times m and the angle will be minus 90 degree times m. Now if I go for simple 0, 1 plus t1 of s, 1 plus t1 of s, so this I have not discussed, but I am giving the summary. If you follow the same procedure, you can get these answers. So that is 1 plus t1 of s, the slope of the line is minus plus 20, sorry, this is because 0, and the face angle is nothing but tan inverse of imaginary part by real part, tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. Now for the term 1 by 1 plus TAS, 1 by 1 plus TAS, that is simple pole, simple pole line is minus 20 dB per decade, slope of the straight line in decibels per decade, correct? In per decade I am writing. I explained what is decade, decibels per decade. Let me put it nicely. So face angle in degrees, right? We have constant term, we have zero set origin, pole set origin, simple zero, simple pole. So since this is a pole, you should take it as minus tan inverse, minus tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. Next, if I have complex, if I have complex 0 and complex pole, then the slope of the straight line will be, for 0 it is plus 40 dB per decade, for pole it is minus 40 dB per decade. Whereas the face angle will be same thing, tan inverse of imaginary part by real part, and here it is minus tan inverse of, because it is pole, right, minus tan inverse of imaginary part by real part. So if you remember this summary sheet, that is enough to solve problems on board plot. What is the resultant slope? What is the slope? What is the contribution of straight line slope in determining the magnitude of the given problem? The advantage of using logarithmic scale is that in logarithmic scale, the multiplication and division will become addition and subtraction. That is the advantage of log scale, correct? If I have log A by log B, I can write it as, sorry, if I have log A by B, then I can write it as log A minus log B. If I have log of A into B, then I can write it as log A plus log B. So in case of log scales, the advantage is that multiplication and divisions will be replaced by additions and subtractions. That is the advantage of logarithmic scale. Next, moving ahead for time response specifications. Now, the main objective of any control system design is to meet the time response specification, that is performance specification. The objective of designing of any control system is to meet the performance specification. What is this performance specification? These performance specifications are nothing but constraints or restrictions that are imposed on the mathematical formulation which are describing the system. So such time response specifications which are important in board plot are, the very first one is bandwidth. Bandwidth is nothing but the range of frequency that you are going to cover in board plot. Next comes gain crossover frequency. Gain crossover frequency is defined as the frequency at which the magnitude of the open loop transfer function, that is G of S into H of S, is unity in linear scale. So what happens in logarithmic scale? The gain crossover frequency is nothing but what? The magnitude of G of J omega into H of J omega. The magnitude of G of J omega into H of J omega will be unity at what frequency it is going to attain. That is known as gain crossover frequency, which means that it is nothing but, in log scale, what it will be? 20 log 10 of 1. 20 log 10 of 1 is how much? It is nothing but 0. In linear scale, the frequency at which magnitude of G of S into H of S is unity, which means in the semi-log sheet or in the board plot, it is the frequency at which the magnitude of G of S into H of S will become 0. This is in log scale. This is in linear scale. Don't get confused. So hence, this is nothing but what? Since it is in log scale, it is in decibels. This is just a magnitude unity. But here it has a unit called decibels. So at what frequency you are getting this is called as gain crossover frequency. That is, here it is omega GC. So the frequency at which the magnitude of G of S into H of S is unity is called gain crossover frequency. In log scale, it will become 0 decibels. Specify the unit whenever speaking in log scale, that avoids confusion. In linear scale, I am not specifying the unit, but whenever I speak in log scale, I should specify the unit as decibels for magnitude. So the frequency at which the magnitude of G of S into H of S becomes 0 decibels is known as gain crossover frequency. Similarly, the next important parameter is phase crossover frequency. Which is denoted by omega PC. This is denoted by omega GC. Gain crossover frequency, phase crossover frequency. So phase crossover frequency is defined as the frequency at which the angle of G of J omega into H of J omega will be equal to minus 180 degrees. The frequency at which the angle of the function G of S into H of S will become minus 180 degrees is called phase crossover frequency. So at what frequency this is satisfied, that frequency is nothing but phase crossover frequency. Next we have a topic called gain margin. This is also very important one, gain margin. As we already learnt in our root locus, the variation of K, that is system gain, causes the change in characteristic equation, which in turn causes change in the roots of the characteristic equation, which are nothing but closed loop poles. So if I connect those poles for various values of increase or decrease in K, I'll get a straight line called root locus. So root locus indicates whether the system is moving towards stability or system is moving towards unstability. So we have certain range for which the K can be increased such a way that the system will not attain unstability. Hence, similarly, gain margin is nothing but the margin for gain available for which you can increase the value of K, that is gain, such a way that the system reaches the verge of unstability. till the system reaching the unstability, I can vary the gain. The margin which is available for me to vary the value of gain such a way that the system won't reach unstability is termed as gain margin. So if gain margin is positive, then I can increase the value of K. If gain margin is negative, then it indicates that the system is already in unstability. I should decrease the value of K. So therefore, by determining the value of gain margin, I will come to know whether the system is stable or unstable and what is the margin available for me if the system is stable, so that I can vary the value of K. Hence, gain margin is very important in system analysis. Next, mathematically, if I write gain margin, mathematically gain margin is nothing but inverse of magnitude of this taken at phase crossover frequency. It is nothing but inverse of magnitude. Inverse of magnitude of g of j omega into h of j omega taken at what? Taken at phase crossover frequency, not at gain crossover frequency. Be careful. It is reciprocal of magnitude of the open loop transfer function measured at phase crossover frequency. Hence, what I can write it? So this can be written as what? Gain margin gm. Gain margin can be written as minus 20 log 10 magnitude of g of j omega into h of j omega taken at omega is equal to omega pc, unit will be decibels. When I specify decibels, I am in log scale. Next one is phase margin. Which is denoted by PM. So phase margin, similar to gain margin, phase margin is the phase lag that I can accommodate in the system such a way that the system won't reach unstability. That is the margin which is allowable for me, the margin which is allowing me so that I can introduce the phase lag such a way that the system won't attain unstability. That is known as phase margin. So mathematically, phase margin means that phase margin is given by 180 degree plus angle of g of j omega into h of j omega, which is taken at here, this is measured as gain crossover frequency. The important observation is that phase crossover frequency is used to measure gain margin. Gain crossover frequency is used to measure phase margin. Don't get confused. This is very, very important. This is a mathematical representation of gain margin and phase margin. This can be directly obtained from the board plot graph. No need to go for equations and calculate how much is that. Just directly by seeing the graph itself, I can take the value of gain margin and phase margin, which I will explain when I take up numerical problems. So these are the important time response specifications one should know in analysis of a frequency response closed loop systems, frequency response systems using Bode plot. Bode plot is nothing but the plot of magnitude and phase angle against the logarithmic scale of frequency. Here x-axis is in log scale, whereas y-axis is in linear scale, wherein which both magnitude as well as phase angle are plotted in a same graph on a same x-axis line, which is a log of omega. Why we are using log of omega? By using logarithmic scale for frequency, I can cover wide range of frequency. So this is the brief introduction for the topic Bode plot. With this very brief introduction to this concept, from our next lecture, I'll take up some numerical problems. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.